O God, the glorious hope of your people, we come to worship you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Shall we stand as we sing our opening hymn, Not My Own, but Saved by Jesus? Standing as I ask our brother Lennox Hyde to open our service in prayer.
Lord, give me, come in here, ask of God, give you thanks and praise, for you deserve.
may be seated. I want to extend a very warm welcome to you this morning to Open Door Believers Chapel. We are a Plymouth Brethren Assembly. And if you are here for the first time or if you are a regular visitor, we want to welcome you. A very special welcome to our North American folks and friends from Indianola. We have our friends, I guess they are family right now, from Indianola Christian Union Church, right, from Iowa. Now, last year, well, no man, Nicole went already, but last year I went to Iowa for the first time, and they were very hospitable to us. Ryan really extended himself, carrying us all over the place, Nick as well, and the whole church. So we're really happy and thankful for you guys being here, and we look forward to the fellowship this week as we serve together in our community. We want to say thanks to Ryan as well. He'll be God's messenger this morning. Ryan has a lot of energy, so I'm kind of looking forward to his message today. Remember, on Wednesday, we have our Believers Fellowship. It begins at 5:30. So all members and regular visitors come out on Wednesday as we fellowship with one another. And remember that a meal is provided at the end. On Friday, we have our Bible Club. Bible Club Friday at 4:30. They are going through the book of Genesis, so bring out the kids on Friday. And then next Lord's Day, we'll have a community worship service just like this, and we start at 10:45. At this time, our sister Cherie Thornton will come and do a sign, and then after that, I'll come with the scripture reading.
Says the mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe, 'cause yes, we can see it, that wonders are still what you do. I love this when y'all, it says, and bodies are still being raised. Giants are still being slain. God, we believe. Yes, we can see that wonders are still what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Thank you.
This morning's scripture reading is taken from Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3, I'll be reading from verse 1 to verse 8. Exodus 3, 1 to 8. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. And he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their suffering, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hittites, and the Jebusites. This is the word of the Lord.
All right, shall we rise? This morning, we give God thanks for the blessed hope that we have in Christ Jesus. Oh, that believers would learn to cherish that hope. First song on the paper, special request, coming all the way by, what do you call it, from Instagram?
FaceTime
with Ryan. FaceTime, all right. Now the team coming in and they want us to sing the song. So what should we do, sing it?
Yes.
A special offering first, right?
Of course, definitely.
All right, and all the people said, Amen.
To be
standing. You look strong. Oh, yes. No talking. At this time, we'll turn our song sheets to the other side. At the bottom of the page, we have there what is called a declaration. It is when we declare God's word in worship. It is the most important aspect of our worship service, as the pure word of God is read. And we hear his voice speaking through each of us. Today's reader is Brother Jeremy and Jacobs. He will be leading the congregation in worship together. Let's read together.
When God made his promise to Abraham, he made a vow to do what he had promised. Since there was no one greater than himself, he used his own name when he made his vow. He said, I promise you that I will bless you and give you many descendants. Abraham was patient, and so he received what God had promised. When we make a vow, we use the name of someone greater than ourselves, and the vow is settled all arguments. To those who were to receive what he promised, God wanted to make it very clear that he would never change his purpose. So he added his vow to the promise. There are these two things, then, that cannot change and about which God cannot lie. So we who have found safety with him are greatly encouraged to hold firmly to the hope placed before us. We have this hope as an anchor for our lives. It is safe and sure, and goes through the curtain of the heavenly temple into the inner sanctuary. On our behalf, Jesus has gone in there before us. This is the word of the Lord.
This time, we'll have a minute or so for silent reflection as we reflect on something that was read in the passage. Shall we rise? Come, we long for thee,
may we no longer roam afar from thee, and at last, dear Lord, we shall see thee face to face. Oh God, no one plays as thou. Oh God, oh God, oh God, thou blessed Lord, how is thy own. Thank you.
give our speaker the utmost attention. They came here to serve the community, to give up themselves willingly in fulfillment of what we just sang. You know, people from all over the world coming here. We're a small church, small assembly. They're not from a big church either. They save and they plan and they come to serve. Just like what we do in summers, we don't go abroad. We stay right here. But and we go across the country, but it's the same principle. And brother, Pastor Proust, we really appreciate you coming to Belize, you know. Somebody didn't believe me this morning. How many years are you coming here now?
Since 2010, so 9 years.
9 years, huh?
9 years, 5 times.
Right, 9 years, right? Coming here. Okay, so you know, try to trick them. Right, I know this way around the city. You get me? All right. Huh? So he thinks, no? Every time you come, it gets bigger, don't it?
What's that?
Every time you come to Belize, the city gets larger.
Absolutely. Yes, bigger.
But you know, this we don't move.
Nope.
All right, yeah. And they are very insulting. They invited me to Iowa. And they are coming here for the sun. Why would I leave my son to go for the cold and ice and... You get me? You get me? Huh? Anyway, we love you, man. I would really appreciate you coming and your team and everything.
Perfect. Thank you. This winter's actually been really, really, really rough for us. I don't know that we just now started to see our ground again, all right? We had about 25 inches of snow in like a month's period. I mean, I can't imagine you guys having even like a half an inch of snow here, you know, but but it was crazy. It's been a kind of a long winter, so we're excited that we get to be here. One of the reasons that we're really excited when we're here is it reminds me a little bit about what heaven's going to be. I really liked what Nicole was sharing during the prayer time. It kind of gave us a glimpse of what heaven is and what it's going to be look like, and he's going to make everything new. But when we're here, and we're here with friends, and we're here with family, it's a little bit of a glimpse of what heaven's really going to be like, because heaven's a chance for people to reunite together. You know, we may be from Iowa, and you may be from Belize or wherever you are from, but yet together we are here because we're worshiping the same God. That is why we're here, and that's a glimpse of what heaven is going to be like, because it doesn't matter necessarily what denomination you go through. It doesn't matter what the color of your skin is. It doesn't matter what country you are from, because we're here reuniting, worshiping, falling at the knees of our Lord and God. That's why we're here. And that's why when we come here, your sunshine is beautiful and your colors are amazing. But what really excites us is the chance that we have to join together to worship the one true God. And thank you for letting us be a part of that. Thank you for bringing us in and your hospitality and your friendliness. Thank you for all of the things that you do for supporting us and giving us smiles and shaking our hands and letting us give your kids high fives. We really appreciate all the hospitality in which you guys give us. Nomar said I had about 2-3 hours here today to share with you. So I figured we'd get started here before we have to have an intermission or something in a little bit. I'm kidding. It's like 90 minutes tops. So have any of you ever, let me transition here for a second. Have any of you ever tried to negotiate things with God? Like, for example, you know, God is calling you to do something, or you know God's laid something on your heart or an individual on your heart. Have you ever had that happen and you sit there and go, God, anybody but that person, or anything but that? Is anybody here like that? Has anybody ever done that? Good. The four of you that raised your hand, amazing. So, look at your neighbors and say, you're lying. So, one of probably the many times in my life that I have done that, was when I was getting ready to figure out what college I wanted to. You see, when I was younger, I knew that God was calling me into the ministry, and I knew that that's where I was supposed to do and go. But what the biggest problem was is I had this nagging feeling on my heart on where God wanted me to go to college. And it was hard because the college that he wanted me to go to was about 600 miles away, which was hard. It was away from my family. It was away from the comfort. It was away from the friends in which I've had. And it was a big decision that I knew I had to make. And so kind of as I was going through my last year of high school, trying to decide what college to go to, I took a lot of different visits to college. And I tried, I went to this college that was about an hour away from our where we live. And I was like, God, this is a great place. This is where you want me. Look at all the things I could do. This is great. And in the pressure upon my heart, I felt God saying, listen, no, that's not where I want you. You know where I want you. And so I took a few other visits, and I went to some other colleges. I'm like, God, look, this would be a good place. You know, this would be a great place. And he's like, no, you know what I want. And I'm like, no, but this will be good right here. And he goes, no, you know what I want. And I think oftentimes like that, we get into this idea of we come up with excuses on why we can't do something that God's calling us to do. We think that we're not good enough, or we're not smart enough, or we're not going to know what to say, or what if they laugh at us, or what if they do this? But when it all comes down to it, is we need to surrender our lives, surrender to him, and be obedient to what he calls us to do. The negotiation may happen a little bit, but ultimately you got to get to the point in your life where you yield before God. And so I want to read with us in Exodus chapter 3. If you have your Bibles, you can turn there in Exodus chapter 3. We're going to take the story of Moses. And we're going to get rid of the excuses that we have in our lives. And so, beginning in verse 1. Now Moses was tending the flock at Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire, from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. And I want to stop there for a second because I want you to take this idea of who Moses is. And most of you probably understand the story of Moses. But Moses was a guy, and he was sitting here just minding his own business. He was just trying to, you know, he kind of ran away because of he committed murder. And he's like, I'm out of there. I don't want anything to do with the Egyptians. And so he kind of went on and he did his own little thing. And he was just kind of minding his own business, raising his kids, having a family, just kind of taking it easy, so to speak. And all of a sudden, in the middle of this, God comes knocking on his door and says, I got a plan for you. You know, he's just minding his own business, and he goes there. And I wondered a little bit as I was thinking about that. And I think about the time that from the time that Moses left Egypt to this time and the years that had passed, what did God do in Moses's life? How did God prepare him for what he was about to ask him to do? You see, one of the biggest things that you have to understand is that God is preparing you to do the things in which he has called you to do. You see, I believe that if you are alive and you are breathing, you are here for a purpose. God has a reason for you here, and he has a reason for you to do something. And while Moses was just sitting there tending the flock, taking it easy, God was preparing him for what he had for him. You see, a lot of times when it comes to God is he prepares us in ways that we don't necessarily like to be prepared in. There are times that we go through things that he's preparing us to mold us and to make us in who he wants us to be. And he takes us the path that we wouldn't go. You see, oftentimes we like to go in a straight line to get to our destination, to where we go. But oftentimes God has a different plan and he takes you different places all over the place to get you to the destination in which he has for you. You see, God is preparing you. I was thinking a little bit about my life and where some of the things that I've been through and some of the things that I felt like God was preparing. So about in the year, I don't know, about 10 years ago or so, 11, 12, 13 years ago, I worked for an elementary school in Iowa. And I worked in special education with behaviorally challenged kids, kids that have ADHD, autism, all kinds of different diagnoses, so to speak. And that's kind of what I did. I did that part-time. I worked at the school, and then I also worked for our church. And so one of the things that I felt like God was preparing me, because never in my wildest imagination did I ever imagine that I'd be working at an elementary school with special ed students. And so as I was working there, sometimes you develop lots of characteristic traits that you realize that you need to have, like patience. When you're working with children with disabilities, sometimes you have to have lots of patience. I liken it to working with Nomar and having to have lots of patience working with Nomar, and so I feel for Nicole, because every day she has to deal.
I love you, baby.
I'm just kidding. Nomar's great. We appreciate everything that Nomar, Jermaine, and all of you guys do. I got to say something nice now, right? You got to say 7 nice things for 1 not and bad thing, but no, we appreciate all the things that Nomar does for us and all that kind of thing. And so, but God is preparing you, and he gave me patience in that time. And you want to know what teenagers I had in the last several years? I've had several different teenagers they're not in elementary school anymore, but I had worked with at elementary school level. They start coming to our church. And so we're able to start taking them to camp and doing different things. You see, God was preparing me to be able to work with some of those students and some of those things like that. One of my favorite students that I ever took, he's graduated now and he's long gone. But my very first student that I ever worked with in the school, I made sure that he got to go to camp and come to church as often as he wanted. And every year he went to camp with us up until he graduated. He went from our little kids camp all the way to high school, and he went every single year. And I think that was God preparing me for the people in which he puts in our lives. You see, I think God's preparing you too. Whatever situation you have right now in your life, wherever you're at in your life, God is preparing you for what he wants you to do. Let's go on with our story. Verse 4. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, "Moses, Moses." And Moses said, "Here I am." Verse 5, "Do not come any closer," God said. "Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground." Then he said, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob." And this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, "I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering." Verse 8, "So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, to bring them out of the land into the good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt." I want you to take note of one thing in that verse. You see, Moses was called by God, but who was the one that was doing the delivering? In verse 8, it says, "So I have come down to rescue my people." You see, God has called us to do things, but is our not our job necessarily to rescue people? We cannot make people follow God. We cannot make people surrender their lives to God. We are mere vessels and instruments and tools in which God uses. But it's God right there that he says, "I have come down to rescue my people." God is in the business of changing the hearts. God is in the business of saving people. God is in the business of taking care of us. And I love that thought there, because sometimes I think we try to make things about us. Oh, I'm not good enough. Oh, they'll never listen to me. Oh, I need to work harder or say more things. I need to say the right things to this individual in order for them to follow God. It's not about that. God is in the business of rescuing. It's your job to be the vessel, to communicate, to try, to love. But it's not your job to get people saved and to rescue them. So God is calling you. And so right there we see in the story that God is calling Moses to do something crazy. He's calling him to stand up to Pharaoh. Let's go on in our story. Verse 11. "But Moses said to God, 'Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?' And God said, 'I will be with you. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain.' Moses said to God, 'Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. And they ask me, what is his name? What shall I tell them?' God said to Moses, 'I am who I am. This is what you say to the Israelites: I am has sent me to you.'" You see, I like this little conversation that Moses has with God. It's like, "Who am I? Like, why would you want me to do this? Do you not know my past? Do you not know my mistakes? Do you not know my failures? Aren't I too much of a failure to be used by you? Who am I that you have chosen me? Why me? Can't you find somebody else better? Sure, you know, go find Aaron. He would be way better. Go find whoever else. somebody else is better than me, right? And he doesn't understand his value. And I think as followers of God and people who are called by God, we need to understand what our value is. You see, our value isn't what our parents tell us we are. Our value isn't what our friends tell us we are. Our value isn't what even other people tell us we are. Our value isn't because of our mistakes, because of our failures, because of the times we messed up. That has nothing to do with your value. Your value is who God says your value is. And God says this, He has bought us and He has paid for us for the price. He paid His life for us. That is our value. That is why we're important. We are His workmanship. And I think it's important that we realize that our value comes from God and not what other people tell us. You see, I think we have a hard time with that, especially in America. I think so many times we look on social media and we look at the things that we don't have and we compare ourselves too often to what we don't have and what we have, and our looks aren't this and she looks like that and he looks like this, and why can't I look like that and why can't I be like that, or why do they have the perfect family and my family's struggling? Why is that person completely healthy and I'm not healthy anymore? And we struggle over and over comparing ourselves, thinking that we're not quite good enough. Because we're trying to find our value in the wrong things. Because our value needs to be in who God says we are. So Moses goes on. Chapter 4, Moses answered, "What if they do not believe me or listen to what I say?" More excuses. "The Lord did not appear to you." The Lord did not appear to you? Then the Lord said to him, "What is it that's in your hand?" "A staff," he replied. The Lord said, "Throw it on the ground." Moses threw it on the ground, and it became a stake, and he ran from it. So would I. Then the Lord said to him, "Reach out your hand and take it by the tail." So Moses reached out and took a hold of the snake, and it turned back into the staff of his staff in his hand. "This," said the Lord, "is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has appeared to you." You see, the next thing to get rid of our excuses is we have to realize our power source. You see, he had a powerful stick, but the stick itself wasn't that powerful. It was just a stick. It was just a staff. But what made it powerful was God. So what is it that's in your hand that you can have right now that God can give power to? One of the things I get to do, and I love it, one of my favorite things to do, and sometimes most frustrating things to do, that I volunteer, I coach a couple baseball teams from time to time in Iowa. And baseball's pretty crazy. We play it forever. I mean, one of my kids started in January, and he'll play until July. He's going to play baseball forever. And so I work with these kids. And one of the opportunities that I like is not only do I get to spend time with my kid by coaching his baseball team, but I get to meet other families in the area. I get to meet and hear other people's stories. I get to invest in kids even more 10-year-olds. You see, that is what's in my hand. And I'm going to spend my time doing some of that stuff. But it's God that has the power source. It's God that's going to speak through me and transform the heart. You see, that's what it's about. It's about God working and rescuing those that need to be rescued. Don't forget your power source. And so when you think about it, when you're going and you have to have a tough conversation with a family member, remember that it's God is your power source. When you're dealing with an illness or something that is challenging and difficult, remember that God is your power source. Remember, it's not the staff. It's not anything like that. But God is your power source. Last, real quick, right here, verse 10. Moses said to the Lord, "Pardon your servant, Lord. I have never been eloquent." More excuses. "Neither in the past, nor since you have spoken to your servant. I am slow of speech and tongue." The Lord said to him, "Who gave human beings their mouths? Who makes the deaf or mute? Who gives them sight and makes them blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now go, I will help you speak and teach you what to say." But Moses said, "Pardon your servant, Lord. Please send someone else." Then the Lord's anger burned against Moses, and he said, "What about your brother Aaron the Levite? I know he can speak well. He is already on the way to meet you, and he will be glad to see you." Verse 15, "You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. And he will speak to the people for you, and it will be as you or your mouth, as if it were God to him." but take the staff in your hand so that you can perform the signs with it. Last, you have to realize that God's glory is revealed in your weakness. God's glory is revealed in your weakness. Because when you, I live by the average that I'm going to do everything possible that I can do in whatever situation that I'm out. If that means I can go 90%, I'm going to work hard and go 90%. But there's always that 10% that God's got to do the rest. So I'm going to do everything I can do and let God do the rest. Do everything I can do and let God do the rest. God's glory is revealed through your weakness. Moses' weakness was he wasn't confident enough. He didn't think he could speak very well in front of people. And so as a result, God's glory and the rescuing that he used for Moses was revealed in his weakness, because that was his weakness, and God had to lift him up and use him and chose to use him to help with the rescuing of his chosen people. So what about you today? Would you bow your heads with me for a second? I want to kind of close here for a second. I want you to spend a moment or two evaluating your hearts. I want you to think about what God is calling you to do. What excuses have you gave him in the last week and why you can't do what he asked you to do? I'm not good enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm too young. I'm too old. Or maybe you're here today as well, and you need God to rescue you from something. Maybe you're here today and you're struggling with a family situation. You're struggling with an illness. You're struggling with a relationship issue. You're struggling with some friends. You're struggling with something at work. I don't know what it is, but I do know that God does. And I do know that you can call out to him. Where do you need God to rescue you right now? Father, we love you. We are grateful for who you are. We are grateful for calling us. We are grateful for you saving us from our sins, saving us from our transgressions, and bringing us into a relationship with you. Father, if there are people here today that don't know you as their personal Savior, if there is somebody here that needs your forgiveness, would you speak to their hearts? Would you challenge them? Would you help them to seek your face? Father, maybe there's people here today that have excuses, that try to negotiate with you, and you have a call on their life. Would you challenge them? Would you help them to be obedient to you and surrender every aspect of their life? Father, thank you for your love and grace. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Foust. Shall we rise?
Praise God from whom?
Now, unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church, by Christ Jesus, throughout all generations, world without end. Amen. God bless you. The team is here. Mingle.
Wednesday, 5:30.
Wednesday 5:30, Friday 4:30, Children Club. Next week, a special speaker here, a Bible teacher from Canada, visiting, will be visiting us.
My mom, I hope you have a name besides my name.